Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back to the International 5 European Qualifiers. We're getting ready to jump into our fourth series, I believe. I am losing track. There is way too much Dota happening right now. And plus, after that recent series, it was just absolute chaos. But we're back, and so are the HellRaisers, as they're going to be taking on the young, rambunctious squad, the Yellow Submarine Group, our open qualifier European squad. So with that, joining us at the panel, I got Hani right here to my left once again. And over on the other side, going to be casting this game for you, we've got the great OD Pixel, along with Mr. Ben Merlini Wu. Gentlemen, how are we all feeling right now? Ready to cast some action-packed Dota?
Yes. Who's Yellow Submarine? Who's
Yellow Submarine are the open
I know, but I don't actually know who's on them.
Oh, it's, I want to say Barash, Dale, Miposhka, PSM, and Fervium.
He nailed it.
That is pretty good.
Good for him. All right. Awesome stuff. And there they are.
There we go.
Now if you want to know what he did without having to look. Now look at how handsome they are. Young. They had to take through a really long
PSM
exhausting
PSM looks
qualifier.
Angry, man. Look at him. It's like, I'm going to slay
I'm ready to play. Wow. I'm ready to play. He's the captain as well. He's like, you do what I say. Or you go home. I don't know how he talks, but I figure he just is that angry. That's how it's going to look. But look at these guys.
Oh,
you know,
so
we know them. We saw them at Red Bull Battlegrounds. They're look at Dredd.
Oh, look at him. He's beautiful. He should go stream, though.
They got the nice uniform sweaters happening right now. They feel in sync, but might be a bit heartbroken. They just came off that crazy series with Na'Vi. They lost 0-2 that second game. Ridiculous. Guys, if you didn't see it, people, if you didn't see it, make sure you check it out. Toby went off the rails. Well-deserved because it was just a clash of a game. But anyways, enough about that series. We have a series happening right now. The draft is actually currently underway, so let's hop into that draft, and we can all do the thing we like to do and talk about the picks. Here we are. HellRaisers are going to be opening up with the 1-2 punch of Wisp and Tony, and on the side of Yellow Submarine, they get their Shadow Fiend, which they love. They've picked this hero 6 times already coming into the qualifier. They have a nice 5-1 record with it, and then they also get the Darkseer, their other top pick, 5 picks and a 4-1 record.
Honey, have you gotten a chance to scrim versus Yellow Submarine?
I have no chance at all to play against those guys.
Okay.
And I'm very surprised that actually with their first series, they went 2-0.
Mm-hmm. 2-0 against London Conspiracy. And you have to remember, London Conspiracy 2-0 Na'Vi. Mm-hmm. So I guess that means they're better than Na'Vi,
I guess, yeah. In the hierarchy of things, we kind of expect them to beat HellRaisers. Because obviously Na'Vi have just beaten HellRaisers.
So Yellow Submarine are going to be our champions of
TI5.
Yeah, that's how it works.
I mean, you could potentially think that way. The other way would be just that people were not having them on the radar, and they're not banning their heroes. And like you were mentioning, now they have their Shadow Fiend and their Darkseer. So again, they kind of get a very comfortable draft.
They might get a Witch Doctor then. That's another top pick for them. If they get that, I'm gonna laugh. But
you better start laughing, Dakota.
Wow. These teams never look at that Dota. Just like I write them all out, the top picks, and these teams that
so
team people don't
here.
Need to know. I mean, they can't pick a Dragon Knight now, right? I mean,
who knows?
Pick a Dragon Knight and have a Safe Lane Shadow Fiend, that'd be pretty dang hilarious. Now, to the discredit, their Witch Doctor doesn't have a very impressive record.
Okay.
They picked it 4 times, and they've only been 1-3. Still a good hero, nonetheless. But enough about what they pick and what they succeeded with. Let's talk about the actual synergy on what it can bring to the table here. Great Vacuum into Requiem. Witch Doctor adds the bit of sustain power. Plus, he obviously has that great counter ability against your Wisp and
Do they pick
Tiny.
Winter Wyvern?
Do they pick Winter
That's
Wyvern?
That's the most unusual part of this. Or I mean, maybe Spirit Breaker Band, too. But
it could be a Respect Band, given the fact that we saw earlier today a Winter Wyvern be very effective with his curse against a Wisp Tiny, just very good at being able to catch out one, because obviously the other one's going to be right there. So,
I do agree. I think it's a decent counter pick towards a Wisp. And especially if you're not that experienced against playing the Winter Wyvern, and you don't know if Yellow Submarine plays that hero, it's going to be... You know, like, you just don't want to take that risk, I believe.
Fair enough. I mean, versus their lineup already, you don't really want to clump. You're not going to, like, TP into the middle of a fight. You're most likely going to be sweeping around, and EO is going to be very far away from the Tiny. So I wouldn't think that Winter's Wyvern would be a high-priority ban versus it. And on top of that, they have a lot of magic damage, so, like, Cold Embrace is meh.
Now imagine, though, if they did have a Winter Wyvern, it's like 800 range, almost feels longer than that. If they catch a good Winter's Curse and they catch a couple around, that makes it only so much easier for someone like a Darkseer to walk in and go... Bring them all together into a Requiem,
That's true.
Then it's destruction at that point. So I think it's also just better to play it safe than sorry.
I got to say, though, to the Winter Wyvern, that when Elsie played it, I felt like it had a quite high impact against Servosus Tiny that was trying to punch someone down, but he couldn't, obviously, because of the physical immunity.
Mm-hmm.
I've seen it a couple times, and all the times in the qualifiers, it's just been a complete whiff.
All right.
But, I mean...
I'm just trying to justify
Yeah, you guys have talked about it, so, I mean, I trust you guys.
Yeah, you better.
Like I did last game, honey.
for HellRaisers' third pick. They're going to be grabbing up the Bane. The response right away, a Rubick, who's pretty good at stealing that pesky Fiend's Grip. Probably the easiest ability to take. You're just going to see him sitting there doing it. Might as well just snag it and take it for yourself, right? So,
the Bane is quite... I think it's a sort of normal pick towards the Wisp, just because you have a Fiend's Grip. It's a good setup for a Wisp relocate. Same with a Nightmare. You have a double setup. And now the Centaur that kind of has the... It's just another setup for the Bane, and I think Centaur fits in that way. At the other hand, that a Tiny and Wisp, you can just walk on the people. I think Centaur ulti is pretty okay for that in that sense as well. So, as well as you need an offlaner, and maybe the most comfortable with a Centaur. I think it's okay in this composition, though.
And if you can stampede during the Wombo combo with Ags, it's incredible. And you can just tank the Witch Doctor ult, and the Requiem, and the wall, and just not care.
OD, you're our Yellow Submarine expert. They have one pick left. They might need that core carry kind of a position. What's tickling your pickle right now?
I'm trying to think back to what I've seen them do before. I've actually, as you said, I've seen a lot of Yellow Submarine. They're in the Dream League. We actually were knocked out by them in the first round of Open Qualifiers.
Congratulations.
When the team went for it. So
what an honor.
You know, when they win TI, I expect a share for helping them with that little boost to start. But the heroes that they've picked, I believe it's Maposhka who's the position one, and Barash, who's normally on the mid lane, who'll take the Shadow Queen. They've picked some weird stuff before. Like, I've seen them pick the Ember Spirit in the safe lane, which has always been a nice bit of fun. Could add to the Wombo combo. I've also seen them run the Chaos Knight as well, and a couple of times where they pick it even though they don't have the IO. They still kind of rate that hero on its own. So maybe we'll see the Chaos Knight come out from the side. But as we were saying, I do like what HellRaisers
have done. They did some research.
There you have. Maposhka Ember Spirit is banned, and well, as I said, it would have worked very nicely with the Darkseid Shadow Fiend, but at the same time, I think Yellow Submarine are going to be very happy that they did get that Barash Shadow Fiend and Dale Darkseid, because that stuff's scary. These guys are the ones to watch on these heroes. They've been doing some great stuff, and they're going to finish it off with the Viper, interestingly enough, which I'd imagine will be that safe lane Viper here.
I was going to say that when you were mentioning the Chaos Knight, I do not think it's actually a very good pick here for them.
Yeah.
Just because Tiny, as soon as he gets his axe, or even his passive, just is so good against melee heroes, that I do not think it would have been a great pick here.
What do you think about the Viper?
The Viper is a pretty good counter pick towards the Tiny, because as soon as you get the ultimate onto the Tiny, Tiny pretty much doesn't hit anymore.
Why? He has overcharge.
It's still not that great.
Still not that great. Okay.
Other than that, though, on the side of Viper, I'm not a Viper fan, period.
Anyone really?
I just don't like the hero too much, because once you fall behind, you're going to have a terrible game, and if it's not the case, then your game is just, to me, it's just always mediocre. Like, Viper never is like this super shining hero. You just sit on your lane, you potentially farm your mech, and then you hope to push together.
That's a core centaur right there, gentlemen. That's an Artez manly man centaur right there. He washes himself with a pine cone. That's how manly he is. They're going to finish out that lineup with a Phoenix. How are we feeling about the HellRaisers lineup now?
I do like it a lot. I think you just have a Tiny Wisp combo, most likely middle. Then you have a Centaur Bane short lane. Bane Centaur is very scary. One sleep is almost always a kill. If one Centaur hits like level 2, level 3, you pretty much have a kill on the target. Especially against the Darkseid as well. Like, Darkseid can't really sit on the offlane at all. He has no time to search. He will die in one combo.
I like it more, too. I mean, and Viper, he's generally pretty good, but they have overcharge for the Viper Strike. They also have Stampede, so he can't kite anyone. He might dominate the Centaur in lane. I have seen that before, but don't skill return, firstly. I remember, whatchamacallit, Toby always talks about how you skill the Shadow Strike versus a Viper as Queen of Pain. He always talks about it, but you can't get those... I remember one matchup, it was like Viper versus Centaur. Centaur skill return, and he just owned himself every single time.
Oh.
Right.
Yeah, that makes sense.
But anyways, both of these have pretty solid lines. As you said, the Shadow Fiend, Darkseid clearly a stable for them, and very comfortable picks, and nice AoE to deal with the Wisp.
All right, so game underway here. Oh, jeez, I can't even give you guys the go. We're going to have action right away.
Paralyzing Cast flying through. Now the Telekinesis onto Dread. It looks like this could be the first blood. This is going to be a defensive nightmare by the Phoenix from Diamond. It doesn't matter. Dale finding first blood. There's a massive hoofstomp onto three of them. Yellow Submarine, they're going to lose Barash here. It's a one-for-one trade. But now Viper here with the Iron Shell chasing down Gretz. They'll find themselves a second kill. It's two-for-one. And now Dale and Maposhka, they're trying to find out for Ninja. He's been helped out a little bit by Gordon, but it's not enough. They lose the Tiny. And now with the Cast by themselves, damn, can they chase this one down? They're trying to get themselves in range here. PSM, he's looking for the telekinesis. He's closing on as the eye of Gotham, trying to get himself up to the high ground. Can they catch him out? They're going to look to chase this one. They're going to keep going. They're still going for it. PSM now turning his attention towards the mid lane. Maybe seeing if they can catch out Goretzka. Oh, they don't know where to go here. Yellow Submarine, what are they going to look for? They found Goretzka. They want to try and dive. This one is a little bit risky. Goretzka coming up. He wants to try and find the nightmare. Both teams, they're desperate for fighting. They're hungry for action. He will get the nightmare to PSM, but he's toggled off by Furby into the low ground. And now Dreddy's trying to come in here with the spirits. Furby's in a lot of trouble because Avalanche comes out. They'll probably find the Witch Doctor, and they do. There's a telekinesis and a cast holding back the side of Hellraiser. Now they're trying to chase down more. They're looking for PSM. Can they do it? Up to the high ground. Dale here with the Ice Shell. He's going to turn around and he's going to go straight for Goddamn, trying to bring him down here. But now he's caught in between all four of the side of Hellraiser. Dredd trying to bite himself through the trees. He's being chased down by Mposhka and Dale here. Oh, now there's the Avalanche onto two, holding back the Darkseer, holding back the Viper. Viper now get the Hills to Goretz. Maybe the side of Yellow Submarine can find him. And suddenly, Furby has turned back up to the fight. He's managed to corner off Goretz. Goretz is stuck off with the rest of his team. They will lose the Bane here on the side of Hellraiser. It's 4-2 for Yellow Submarine. And, well,
ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Yellow Submarine taking against Hellraisers. Okay, with that said, obviously, Odie Pixel is going to be your point caster. Joining him is going to be Ben Merlini-Wu. Holy crap, this is going to be one hell of a show. Gentlemen, please, it's your honor. Have at it.
Viper actually ran out of mana. How ridiculous is that? And, I mean, Yellow Submarine, they have incredible synergy. Like, I can just see from that play that they move together as a unit. No one backs off and then turns around. They're like, they fully commit to it. A very low HP Darkseer walks uphill. He's not scared. He knows his team will back him up. And just incredible synergy already from the minus 45 seconds.
It's very impressive stuff. I mean, what went wrong there for Hellraisers? Should they have said at a point, right, we've got to stop this. Our level one team fight isn't as good as them.
Well, Tether's pretty useless. Yeah. Nightmare is also pretty useless. Centaur is mediocre. But their spell cooldowns are really long. Hoofstomp as well as the Avalanche. And then you have this Viper who's on the opposite side, just like right in the middle of them with an Ion Shell as well as a Darkseer. And I assume Darkseer has a Stout. So both these targets are like very tanky targets who are just dishing out a lot of damage. And I mean, Ion Shell doesn't do that much damage at level one, but when you're hitting like two or three heroes and you multiply that by two because two heroes are Ion Shelled, it definitely adds up. And on top of that, the coconuts from old Witch Doctor.
I might catch out Mposhka here. He's got a point in Crisis Skin. It's not going to be enough to save him from the burst damage there. Artis and Goretz do take him down. And off the back of that, I think it's interesting to talk about the lane decision from Yellow Submarine. So you've got Viper on the solo off lane, and at the moment, Rubick hanging around the bottom with the Darkseer on the safe lane. What's up with this?
Well,
he's doing the pull, isn't he?
Yeah. I don't think either hero can really survive that offlane, Darkseer or Viper. I mean, Viper was already level 2 when he got there, right, with the Corrosive Skin.
It was,
so
yeah,
okay, so with the dual lane, yeah, should be...
Yeah, this is safer.
This is much safer. I mean, Viper's not that bad of a matchup versus Phoenix, because you can just Corrosive versus the damage over time and just kind of own him. But at the same time, Darkseer will be able to utilize the jungle, I think, a lot more effectively in this lane. But it was a very smart decision for them to just put two heroes. If they put zero or one, I don't think it's very good.
I think they're trying to go for it, but again, Fervian is there with the Nightmare toggle. I mean, obviously now against this aggressive dual lane, how does Bane kind of stand as a solo lane support?
Not that great, because he doesn't actually offer that much damage, I say, until level 3. His level 1 Brain Sap has been buffed, I think, in the most recent patch with lower mana. But at the same time, he is level 3 already, so that's pretty good. I think they reskilled it, but it's a lot of pure damage. But on top of that, Viper is just not that great of a target because of that corrosive. And then they have the heal as well as the coconuts, and he has to get into melee range to hoof stomp.
Okay, and looking at the mid lane at the moment, obviously Barash did have a little bit of a helping hand at the start when we saw Witch Doctor end up here, but he's still doing pretty well here now with Rubick hanging around. I guess at the moment, is this the best place for the Rubick to be, as he's not needed bottom with the Darkseer?
Well, they play a lot differently. A lot of teams, they try to make their strongest lane stronger, mm-hmm. but instead they're making their weak lanes even, which is, you know, instead of trying to, let's say, win one, lose one, and then wash one, they try and at least break even in all three. And they're confident that they can outplay their opponents in these sort of lanes. That's actually what I like to see from teams, and just try and contest all three. And, you know, if you're more skilled and it's a three supposedly even lanes, then you can outskill them and then win all three lanes, which is much better, obviously, than one win, one wash, one loss.
Dale just going to surge himself away from Goddamn on the IO. And I'm going to spot the fact that there's at least one stack coming out from the side of Yellow Submarine. Top lane here with the telekinesis pulling back Artez. There was going to be a TP in, but it was cancelled in the end. Looks like they didn't feel that they could get that kill, the Yellow Submarine.
And, you know, they devote a lot of resources to these two lanes, too, with the Sentry on top taking out the D ward, with the Observer ward in mid very, very early to ensure Shadow Fiend has an early farm, another Sentry to guarantee their lanes there, all about winning the lanes that most teams would sacrifice.
Oh, and they found a kill! Yellow Submarine! Double kill for the Viper, suddenly on the top lane, and from what I can see from the PSM with the plays.
He's a dirty hero. He's very difficult to deal with when you have a, like, there's just unexpected. Like, usually when you have a hero, it's like, okay, we can do this amount of damage, 75% magic resistance, we can burst him down. But against a Viper, you can't really right-click chase down like you normally would with a support. You also, you know, have to bring out your calculator because of the magic resistance. You don't know whether he has level 1, level 2 corrosive, and then, again, you have the voodoo heal, voodoo restoration from the Witch Doctor. So it just messes with the math a lot, and that's why you'll see a lot of...
Avalanche onto Fervinen with the toss back as well. Witch Doctor's in a bit of trouble. Has got the voodoo restoration. It's not enough there. Nice. Bit of action there, going for the side of HellRaisers, bringing it to 6-4, but like 10 minutes in. Sorry, 5 minutes in and 10 kills. There's a lot of action this game.
Does that see the Observer?
Ooh, that's unlucky there. Unlucky there for HellRaisers. But Ben, so far looking at this game, is this a brilliant start for Yellow Submarine, or is it not that big of an advantage at this point? HellRaisers still going to be very happy?
It's really good because they're forcing HellRaiser to do all these things that they normally wouldn't. Like, they already had to put the Bane in the mid. Usually Tiny Wisp is a self-sufficient lane. They've had to have the support constantly try and deal with this Viper in the top lane. Now Yellow Submarine has an advantage because of support left. Now they're able to pull. So they're making HellRaisers make all these difficult decisions that you normally wouldn't have to. I think HellRaisers is responding to it very, very well. But at the same time, there are a lot more potentials to mess up when this amount of pressure is on you in the first 6 minutes of the game. We already have 10 kills.
Indeed. I mean, I kind of feel the issue here at the moment is as well, obviously the fact that Bane came to the mid lane, leaving the Centaur alone against both the Viper and the Rubick. It's the fact that Artez, he's losing out in CS here now. He's 17-3 against the 25-7 on the Viper. And I guess the reason why you run a core Centaur is to get that early Blink Dagger timing. And you're not going to find that on your own against a Viper.
Yeah, he'll still be useful for Stampede. At least he's level 6. So it's not the worst thing in the world. And yeah, they can come back later with it, but that's definitely, I think, a lane that most teams would look at and be like, okay, we're just going to sack it because it's a really strong dual lane. So I really like Yellow Submarine's response, and it's definitely paying off. This is not what HellRaisers expected in the early game. You expect, you know, safe lane try with Viper, off lane Darkseer, and then the two supports maybe ganking mid now and then, probably sitting behind Shadow Fiend, usually stacking, and their playstyle is completely different, and I can definitely see why they went 2-0 earlier.
It's an impressive start so far from the side of Yellow Submarines, and obviously the fact that they did come from the open qualifiers, a lot of people probably wasn't going to be expecting to see a lot from them, but it's still early days, and well, mid lane, we're going to see Afaninja turn around here with an Avalanche and a toss, back onto Brash, now he's trying to clear out Afaninja here with the raises, Afaninja still trying to go with this with the punches, now he just turns around, puts the six charges with the Voodoo Restoration, it's not going to be enough, they do lose the Shadow Fiend, and the Hail Raisers, they might be able to find the Witch Trucks as well with the Stampede, the Witch Trucks is going to, will go down to a double kill, and at the same time on the top lane, this is great for Hail Raisers, they might find themselves a third kill here, and they will do indeed as they bring down the Viper. And you're talking about how effective the Centaur can be with that Stampede just in level 6 and making a lot of things happen there globally.
Yeah, Shadow Fiend just manned up. He got tossed, and instead of running back, he's just like, screw you, I'm going to try and race. He actually whiffed where he's there, but even then it wouldn't have mattered on the Wisp. But, I mean, nice plays by HR all around. Now they devote 3 to top, 2 to mid, and just let the Darkseer farm so they can win 2 of the 3. So I like what they're doing with this. Centaur, he's pretty much coasting to his blink after that. After that bout in the top lane. Oh, he's going Vanguard. Or Pipe. Interesting. Yeah.
You're not too happy with that one?
I mean, if you need an item to help you win the lane, then that's fine. But generally, you already have Tranquils. So that should be enough. It just delays your blink so much. And you want that blink ASAP. So you can blink, stomp, and then relocate and get an easy kill on a high priority target like a Shadow Fiend, even a Darkseer. Or Viper would be pretty good for them. But the longer you wait for that blink, what are you going to initiate with? Like, Phoenix is not the greatest relocate partner. Bane is mediocre without a blink. And, I mean, that's pretty much it.
Oh, this is very nice. HellRaisers obviously just went down to pop two very aggressive dire wards out. But Yellow Submarine, they smoke outside of the range of the ward, and now they go straight under it. So HellRaisers are going to feel safer than they should be because they don't know this is coming. PSM with the telekinesis onto Afaninja. Do they have the burst damage to bring down this Tiny Nose? Going to be able to turn around and get out the Avalanche. But in fact, the Gret's Nightmare onto Shadow Fiend allowed him to avoid the damage from that initial Avalanche burst. And Yellow Submarine, they'll try and walk this one off. They might lose Fervian here, and they will do indeed as a toss comes through from Afaninja on the Tiny. They do find a kill there. A little bit of a mess, and I mean, again, we are seeing the use of Stampede definitely helping out the side of the Dire here.
Wow, that was a 4-on-3. That was huge for HellRaisers, and they weren't even that prepared for it. We saw the TP come out immediately, but yeah, that was great. And as you said, they misfired a little bit there. Tiny probably should have died.
Now we're going to see Darkseer. He's going to head up to this top lane, and I guess obviously they realize the fact that Centaur is here on his own, and Dale should be able to find a lot of farm here without being too disrupted. And we can see at the top of the board at the moment, 54 CS on this Darkseer. So Dale having a very good game. Maposhka just going as aggressive as he can here onto Dread, trying to harass back the Phoenix. But there's going to be a wraparound here from HellRaisers as we see them go straight into the Radiant Jungle. Smoked up. You've got Gretz, Goddamn, and Afro Ninja leading the way here. They're going to go towards the mid lane at the moment. Both Fervian and Barash are hanging around.
Notice they went the long way around. They wanted to look for stacks first, and there's no stacks for them to work with. If they wanted to just kill mid, they wouldn't have gone up that hill.
Okay.
And trying to do some economic damage.
Now Maposhka's got 3 points in the Corrosive Skin. Trez and Aquila, is it going to be enough to save him from this burst damage? It doesn't look like it. He's going to go down here, trying to get out the Viper Strike, but wasn't able to. And now, well, Icarus dive forward. There's going to be a Paralyzing Cast coming out onto Dread, but Dread, he's just going to chase this one down. And with four members of the side of HellRaisers, there's nothing that Fervian can do to stop that. And that's going to be a double kill there for Tiny on the bottom lane.
I did not like the positioning from Viper. They were smoked for a long time. They smoked from mid. They went bottom. They wrapped around the mid. They waited around a little bit. They checked for stack. And that's like 30 seconds. And then your Spidey senses go...
Oh, this is nice in the mid lane. They're trying to go on Altez. Obviously, PSM had the Avalanche stolen. Wasn't quite enough, though, to bring him down, even with that final Fade Bolt, the Stick Charges and the Vanguard paying off. And now with a relocation from Goddamn, he says he's in for the solo kill, and he'll find it there. Picks off the Rubick on the back of that fight.
So who's actually going mech here? We see Shadow Fiend going for a Buckler. He went Arcane. I guess he's a Blink Rush for him. And, I mean, they have 3 mech carriers, in theory.
Yeah, they do indeed, yeah, with the Viper as well. We'll see who goes for it. Well, top lane, Dell still applying the pressure here. There's going to be a TP back from Goretz. At the moment, net worth, it feels fairly even. And now the fact that HellRaise is 11-6, arguably Yellow Submarine giving away a little bit of what they started with. And now on the bottom lane, they're going to try and find out for Ninja here. He has got the toss stolen. Well, with the Paralyzing Cast coming out to Tiny, he's going to be backed up here by Goddamn, trying to heal him back up. And now for Ninja, he just wants to go straight in. He wants to try and find some kills for himself. He'll be able to bring down PSM, and maybe they can find Fervian as well, chasing down the Witch Doctor. He will get the cast out, but the bounce is... No, he didn't actually get the cast out. He was already dead. Double kill there for Afro Ninja. And, I mean, this is looking a little bit rocky for the side of Yellow Submarine. Pun not intended there for Tiny, but 13-6 now, and a lot of these kills are going the way of the Tiny IO combo, which isn't great.
Especially now that he has a Blink Dagger, so, I mean...
Well, Goretz, he's going to Nightmare himself here, but the Viper ticks through that, and he will go down. So they do find a trade, but still, at the moment, HellRaisers, they've stepped up the tempo of this game, man. And it looks like it's a little bit too much for Yellow Submarine at the time being. And look, Afro Ninja, he wants to go for more. Blinking straight in with the Avalanche and toss onto Barash. There's a Phoenix here as well. There's nowhere for the Shadow Fiend to run. And you can tell HellRaisers have done this Tiny IO thing before, because it's pretty much textbook. Tiny's 9-1 so far and 2 assists. And we're just 12 and a half minutes.
Yeah, you don't need a Centaur Blink if you have a Tiny Blink.
I think they find more as well. They've got a Stampede to set this one up. Miposhka's been caught all out. Now with the toss, the Avalanche, the Stampede, everything being thrown. This is a godlike streak for Tiny. And HellRaisers, they might not have had the best start to this game, but they're showing Yellow Submarine there. Oh, the PSM, he was hanging around here. Maybe they can find some return kills, and they do, in fact. They bring down the Tiny, and they will get the IO. So a nice reaction there from Yellow Submarine, making the best of a bad situation and, you know, shutting down the Tiny IO combo. And who, in fact, did the godlike gold go to?
Witch Doctor.
Witch Doctor. That's nice for the Aghanims, if he wants to. But, I mean, at the moment, this is pretty action-packed game, Ben. And, I mean, is it favoring the side of HellRaisers with the kind of lineup they have? Are they kind of built to fight more than Yellow Submarine?
Well, a lot of they're definitely better built to gank,
yeah,
for sure, right? Like Viper, can't really gank that much. Darkseer, mediocre at getting solo kills. So HellRaisers have just much better solo kill potential, which is why it's looking so grim for Yellow Submarine. But once Yellow Submarine gather up with a mech, you know, we see the cloak on Darkseer, they're going a lot of team fight items. And once they get, like, vacuum walled into a Requiem with, like, coconuts into a death ward, you know, that's going to be really devastating. And, you know, especially if they can kill like the egg in the team fight, it's going to be massive. So we haven't really seen the full strength of Yellow Submarine's lineup, and it's looking a little bit grim. So they just have to change their play style, which means sitting behind targets they think they're going to get relocated on, not farm out as aggressively, and try and kill the Wisp ASAP. Because going for the Tiny, like you saw bottom, 2 heroes went for Tiny. He was at like 400 HP, and he managed to live and get a double kill. So they can't underestimate Stampede. They have to somehow kite the Tiny, go for the Wisp, and try and combo them with Vacuum Wall. So
smoke on smoke here. There's three members on the side of HellRaisers down here, but they, of course, do have that relocator available to make it a full 5-on-5. Who's going to get the jump on who here? Artez looking for the wraparound. Has a double damage rune here as well. Yellow Submarine, they're going to go straight past. And looks like this is... Are they going to be aware of this one? No, the smoke has been finished on the side of HellRaisers. And
Artez just needs to wait up the hill. They have good vision. During nighttime, if you have a reserve reward and you're on high ground, you're in a great spot. Ideally, they'd have a sentry, but...
Oh, they're stampeding out. They're questioning whether they want to find this one. Now Artez does go in, but he's been hit down on by Barash, and now they will find the centaur kill search one out, but now Tiny Io come in. There's going to be a vacuum and a very nicely placed wall here, trapping all three of them. And now Maposhka, he's just trying to go to work. Dread did get out to the supernova, but he was just on the edge of the fight. Didn't actually manage to achieve that much. He's a 2-for-2 so far. Do the side of HellRaisers lose any more? Do Yellow Submarine lose anything? Dredd's going to just summary himself up to the high ground. Looks like he will be okay for the time being, just simply TPing out, but 2-for-2 there. And I've got to say, Yellow Submarines dealt with that quite well. I mean, HellRaisers, they had the Tiny Hour coming in, but Afro Ninja, he seemed a little bit scared about that one. He didn't seem to fully commit himself.
Centaur actually didn't fully commit. He had a 4-man stun, but that's what you get for not finding under Observer Ward. The smoke pops, he sees like one hero and he doesn't see the three behind him. If he just stampedes and blink stomps on four immediately and they get a relocate like close to the Dire Ancients, then they just completely wreck HellRaisers, they completely wreck Yellow Submarine that fight. But because he hesitated, they were actually able to steal the stampede, mm-hmm. and he didn't get an ideal initiation off. So it could have been so much better for HellRaisers that fight.
I mean, at the same. So now we've got the mech finished on the Shadow Fiend. Witch Doctor, of course, working towards that Aghanim's. And Dale, I guess, does he just go for the fully fledged pipe now as his next item?
Pipe's pretty good.
Yeah.
They don't have that much physical until Tiny gets his items, but he went Blink Dagger first, so his right click is going to be pretty paltry.
Look at this Yellow Submarine. They're hungry for action. They're going to smoke up straight away. There's going to be Haste Rune that is going to be bottled up here by
Goddamn.
How
are they going to kill him?
They've got a Surge here. They're trying to get him with the Telekinesis. The vacuum into Telekinesis. Very nice there from Yellow Submarine. Allow them to catch out Io. They're going to look for Roshan here now.
What's the cooldown on Phoenix Egg? They need that to fight, and I don't know if they can fight without it. 12 seconds.
Yeah, do they get away with this Yellow Submarine?
With Phoenix ult being that low, I don't think so.
Well, let's see. I'm seeing Phoenix throwing the old spirits. He's on the high ground.
Oh, he doesn't have enough mana.
They do have this Observer Ward here for the Radiant, so they know exactly where Dredd is. Roshan now sitting at half health. They've got everything available for the side of Yellow Submarine. They've got the wall. They've got the Death Ward. And Yellow Submarine, they're looking content to continue this one. The side of HellRaisers is just looking for the perfect initiation. They've got the IO back
they
now.
They can... Oh, the fake Roche play. They're so cheeky, this team. I like it.
Oh, there's your vacuum onto two. They put on the wall as well. Now with the damage coming onto Artez, can they bring down the Centaur? He did get the Stampede off, and now with the Supernova from just inside the pit, so they can't actually see him. And now with the Death Ward from the side of Yellow Submarine, bringing down Alpha Ninja. They've managed to find two. It's a 2-for-1 trade so far. Dredd to get off the full Supernova. Bringing Barash low. There's the Voodoo Restoration. Is not going to be enough to save the Shadow Fiend. Now Dredd, he could be in trouble because PSM, Fervian, and the Posca closing down on him. It's a 3-for-2 so far. Tiny has bought back, but I don't know what he can do at this point. Now they're going for more, Yellow Submarine. No, Afro Ninja's fan. Toss and the Avalanche does bring down PSM. And Poshka here hitting onto Gretz. Gretz just sitting on the high ground. And now Afro Ninja's coming back in. Right, Yellow Submarine need to be scared, and they are indeed. Poshka looking to TP out. Will just get himself out. I think that's going to be a toss.
Man, this Yellow Submarine team is something else. They go for these really unusual and really like on-the-fly moment plays. Their strategic value is, it's really next level.
I mean, the question is now. I mean, who is taking this Roshan?
Well, they don't have Tiny Buyback and they don't have the Egg, so I think they can actually... They need to hover around the area a little bit more.
Indeed. We're going to see HellRaisers just hang around here in the Radiant Jungle, ready to try and block Yellow Submarine off if they come in for this one. There's going to be the TPs from the side of the Radiant coming down to the Tier 2. They're ready to try and move back in. And they're ready to fight. We saw their Rubick already with double braces.
The Vanguard. Yuck.
You're not a fan?
I mean, Crimson Guard's okay, but they have so much magic damage that I think another item would have been better. I mean, Blink is usually the go-to, and they have a little bit less options to initiate. Oh, that's why he didn't Blink in, because he didn't have a Blink. That was silly of me. I was wondering why he didn't Blink in to initiate.
Gretz, he tries to TP out. There's going to be a Telekinesis there, and we'll throw out the Nightmare onto Dale. It doesn't matter, though, because PSM with a stolen Brain Sap will be able to bring down Bane there. This game is great, Malini. It's 16-20, and we're, 19 minutes in, and it certainly could still go either way this match.
Roshan's really important here, because they have a very ulti-based lineup. I mean, relocate kind of, but Stampede, Phoenix Egg, and Fiend's Grip, all very important in their team fights. And if Yellow Submarine can survive that, I mean, if either team can get it, because both teams are very ulti dependent, so this should be an easy Roche. Phoenix is too late to the party. They need him there right now.
They're going to try something here. They're going to Sunray in. Could the side of Yellow Submarine bring this one down? And now he goes in with a supernova. Can they see him? Oh, they're trying to hit him. They do try and get some punches in. But now with the vacuum and the wall drop by Yellow Submarine, they're trying to bring down Artez. Artez is still alive here. And they've actually lost the Shadow Fiend here. They're all getting incredibly low. Artez will drop as a dominating kill streak here for Fervin. And now with the death wall from the high ground, it's going to be a double kill as he also brings down Dread on the Phoenix. And now with 3-for-2 trade favoring the side of Yellow Submarine. Yellow Submarine just go to look back and finish this one. But they've actually lost another one. They might lose PSM as well. Yes, they do. It's going to be a double kill for Io from the high ground, just blowing them all up with his balls. Fervian tries to turn around against Goretz, but Goretz, he just drops the Fiend's Grip. They want to take down this Witch Doctor. It's a very slow and very painful fight, but they do find Fervian. The buybacks are coming out. Are Yellow Submarine going to be able to do anything about HellRaisers taking this roast? They need to get themselves to the pit ASAP. We see Rubik making a run for it. I don't think he gets there in time, and he doesn't. HellRaisers claim the Roshan, and it's going to be Aegis on your Io.
Well, wow, having that T1 tower still up is...
Hello. That's a bit cheeky. There's going to be a little vacuum onto the high ground. Now, can the side of Yellow Submarine do anything for this? Goretz is just going to TP himself out. Dale is trying to find himself in. Barash has now turned up to the party. Dread could be in a bit of trouble. And oh, with a raising of Fate Bolt to the backside, they'll lose the Phoenix. Worth noting, of course, with the buyback, he's down for a good minute at this point of the game. Artez has turned up. And well, Mish Posh is going to find the slow here. There's going to be the Stampede popped. Now, Afro Ninja coming in. They're trying to blow up PSM. But he's being kept alive by the mech. He will finally fall. But they've lost Artez the side of HellRaisers. They might lose more as well because Mish Posh and Barash, they're trying to get Afro Ninja. They want to try and find Goddamn here as well. He's got to relocate in 3, in 2, in 1. He's ready to go. There's going to be a death fall, though. It doesn't matter. Aegis will be popped. We're going to see Afro Ninja trying to walk himself back up the lane. Are they going to look for round 2 here on Goddamn? Now he tethers. He's got it. Well, no. He's not got the relocate because I think he casted it just before he lost his first life with the Aegis. So this isn't great for HellRaisers. They might lose Afro Ninja as well. He's got the toss here onto Barash, but it doesn't matter with the Voodoo Restoration. Yellow Submarine, they're standing strong. It's going to be a double kill for Viper. And correct me if I'm wrong there, but I think, yeah, the Io tried to use Relocate just as he died. Mm-hmm. And then he came back without it. And that meant him and Tiny weren't in the greatest positions.
Yeah, I mean, he could have saved it. But, I mean, he's under a lot of pressure there. He thought they could fog him. Wow. Yellow Submarine, they're an incredibly resilient team. Like, sometimes they're down in kills. Sometimes they're, like, not in great positions. But they fight so darn well as a team.
This is crazy. And Goretz, you're chilling on the tree line here. Yellow Submarine will be able to take this tier 1. And what's he getting? Oh, just some wards out. He's fine. And we're seeing Bane obviously working towards what I imagine to be a good old Glimmer Cape. Has that Shadow Amulet on him at the moment. 23-27, but still, the side of HellRaisers, they've got this tiny 9.2k net worth. How's he doing in terms of the old items? He has got that completed Aghanims on top of the Blink Dagger.
What about Centaur?
And how's he doing on top of the Vanguard? Yeah, he's getting close to it. And with the Blink Dagger on Centaur, this is going to step up the fighting potential for HellRaisers by a huge amount, and they can certainly look to catch out Yellow Submarine. But at this point, Yellow Submarine, as a side, with the Voodoo Restoration, with the mech, with the fact they've got heroes like the Viper, they're fairly tanky. And there's an Aghanims on Witch Doctor 22 minutes in.
That godlike streak. Picked up.
I mean, this game's pretty insane. I believe the stat was there this so far in the qualifiers is the game with the 4th highest kills, and I don't think we're anywhere near an ending at this point, Melini. This game is... We're going to see a few more major clashes. They're trying to push it on the bottom tier 2 at the same time. HellRaisers, they're looking to put a bit of pressure onto the tier 2 in the mid lane, and they will be able to force back some TPs. Afro Ninja, he throws in the cheeky avalanche. Now a blink forward from Dale, and he'll find the vacuum here onto Tiny. There's going to be a cast bouncing out as well. It won't connect onto the Afro Ninja. Simply tosses back the darks here. Now Witch Doctor trying to go in. Barash is there as well. Tiny will get the blink out, and it looks like he will be able to get himself away here.
That Witch Doctor Ags pickup is huge, though. I don't really think they can expend resources to stun him. Like, Bane is going to be under a lot of pressure because, I mean, maybe once he gets his Shadow Blade, he'll be okay, or Glimmer Cape. And then Centaur, you know, he's usually focused down by the Viper, so he can't blink. And then Tiny's usually the one initiating, so if they can channel that Witch Doctor ult and just, I mean, wombo combo them is the dream.
It is indeed. Let's see what goes on here as we're seeing, well, Goretz maybe seeing if he can spot something out here. Obviously with a Nightmare or Fiend's Grip setup, they do have the relocate available on top of it all. But Barash on his Shadow Fiend, 2.6k gold coming up on top of the Ogre Club. So he's just under about 400 away from his BKB. And against this kind of lineup, BKB is going to be pretty huge in these scene fights.
Mm-hmm. Hood coming out on Darkseer. We see the Glimmer Cape up on Bane. Glimmer Cape's going to be huge for the Tiny, so he doesn't have to get BKB next. But, I mean, he still has to deal with that massive physical damage coming out from Witchdog, from SF, from Viper, as well as the own his own illusions.
And we're going to see on the bottom lane the side of HellRaisers they're grouping up. Worth noting as well, Dread's farm at the moment looking very healthy with the Factor. He did get that early Midas, coming up to 3k on top of the plate now, so he's closing in on enough money for that Shiva's Guard, if that's the item of choice in. Well, of course, with the Tiny and Eye, they should be able to make short work of this tower. They're going to back themselves off. They're aware that Yellow Submarine might want to do something in reaction, and they certainly do the side of the Radiant. They're all here prepared to fight behind that tier 2. They're missing both the Rubick and the Viper, who are still hanging around here on this top lane. And Afro Ninja and Goldam, they don't want to fight here at the bottom. They're happy with forcing the TPs, and they just want to look to continue their farm elsewhere.
Well, they have to stick together. Yeah. If they don't, I mean, the relocate is just going to turn a 1v2 into a 3v2. So they, the way they're playing is very solid. Like, they're not giving HR many opportunities to run away with a game. And that would be either, like, split pushing them down or just picking them off in packs of two or three. So they're just grouping together as five. That's where their strength is. They know that. HellRaisers know that. And the push continues.
I mean, Yellow Submarine, they've already done a little bit of work on this tier 2 on the bottom lane, but at the same time, HellRaisers, they've already done a little bit of work on the tier 2 on the top lane. Both sides looking to finish off what they've started here. Let's see who forces who back first.
It should be, HR should force Yellow Submarines back, just because Tiny Wisp is stronger as a push, and
vacuum onto two. They're going to drop the wall here as well. Downey's a little bit of backup. There's going to be a toss onto the Darkseer, and they'll actually relocate themselves out. Artez on the bottom lane. He's gone in onto Barash and PSM. There's going to be a nightmare in Maposhka. Now with the Fiend's Grip onto Barash. They're holding two in place, and Nafo Ninja blinks forward. He's turned up, bringing Barash low, but he pops the BKB now with the Requiem Souls. Barash, he's looking to turn it. He's taken down the Tiny. Dread's going to have to dive away here on the Phoenix. Garrett's hiding in the tree line. What a BKB. What a Requiem. And now Maposhka and PSM, they won't quite be able to bring down Dread here for the Supernova as he comes out. They've lost PSM here on the Rubik. Artez trying to TP himself out of Maposhka. He TPs away as well. They did lose the Shadow Fiend as Bane was able to finish him off with what I can only imagine to be the Brain Sap. But very nice play there from Yellow Submarine in reaction to the jump in from HellRaisers, allowing them to get that kill onto Tiny at the start of the fight.
Man, that Phoenix ult. Yellow Submarine, they saw immediately the two supports win and right clicked it. And then the last projectile was in the air as it popped.
Very, very close fight there between the two sides. But ending 2-2, obviously both teams losing a core and a support on top as well. But Darkseer, he's continuing to get very close to his Pipe of Insight. Dread now has got the finished Shiva's Guard off as well. And obviously we're just seeing the Viper as well. He had about 2.6k gold on top of the point booster. So he's going to have the Aghanim Scepter relatively quickly.
They have to find some way to deal with the Fiend's Grip. And I don't know. It's going to be very difficult because they don't have like a Shiva's or you know, Blink Daggers on. I mean, Darkseer can use Blink Vacuum, but you don't want to do that to search for a Glimmer Caped Bane Elemental. And at the same time, you can't let your Shadow Fiend get Fiend's Grip for 5 seconds. But now with Pipe, with Mech, with BKB, maybe he can survive that. So next Roche should be respawning pretty soon. And I mean, HellRaisers, I mean, both teams have really good team fight around the Roche.
Alpha Ninja, he's just 1k away of a recipe of the Assault Cuirass. So we're going to see both sides having some very scary items on board for the next potential team
fight. AC is a double-edged sword here because he's going to get it
with the illusions. Yeah.
So I don't know. I think some players would prefer a BKB just because it's a much safer item. But if you're confident that you're not going to get hit by the wall or that the illusions are going to die very quickly, then I think AC is a good choice. Or if you're going to be farming, split pushing, and pushing towers down. But there is a chance for it to turn back on. I guess it just negates itself, but you don't want to waste, you know, 5,000 plus gold on an item that can be used against yourself.
That's true. I mean, we'll see how careful Alpha Ninja plays in the next team fight, making sure not to get himself caught out by that wall. Bane will be able to deny the tower there from the side of Yellow Submarine on the bottom. But still here, they're going to have to do something about this, because HellRaisers, with the Tiny Eye, they're trying to force some kind of reaction from Yellow Submarine. And they will get Dale himself back here on the Darks here.
Yeah, their five-man strat doesn't work anymore just because their pushing is so incredibly weak. And if they TP one at a time, if they see one TP, then they'll immediately relocate and pick off the other four. So they have to back off together as a team, and because of that, they get extra damage on the tower.
Oh, the double back here with the smoke. They'll be able to catch out Artez. He is going to be Glimmer Caped, and he's going to try and ward this one off. Does get the Hoot Stomp off to cancel the Death Ward, and very nicely done there from Artez, surviving a four-man smoke.
Man, that Glimmer Cape. That item is so incredibly good. I would be highly surprised if it wasn't nerfed in the next upcoming versions. But enough of that.
Oh, Dale. Goretz is going to be able to get himself close and personal here for the Fiends group. Dale is in a lot of trouble. They're going to drop the Supernova here as well in case there's any reaction from Yellow Submarine. Now we're going to see Brash. He just pops the BKB. They're trying to bring down Goretz, but they are going to get caught by the stun here from Dread. And now the pipe has come out from Yellow Submarine. And this is going to take them quite a lot here with the Voodoo Restoration as well. But at the same time, look at this. HellRaisers, they're just ripping them apart. They're forcing the fight in the mid lane, and they're also pushing down on the top lane. They've taken down the tier 3. The side of HellRaisers, they did lose the Phoenix. They've been Avalanche thrown out, and now the relocate out from Io. We'll be able to save the Tiny. It looks like Goddamn's probably going to go back to his death here. I don't think they bring the Tiny back into this one. And has he got the Glimmer Cape? He has got the Glimmer Cape in 1 second. And then pop down a sentry. And yeah, there's there's none amount of glimmering.
I think it's definitely worth it for HellRaisers. Yeah. You will get a T3 as well, some damage on the range racks in exchange for your Phoenix and your IO. That thing is...
PSM. Where's he relocating here? Ah, the relocate D ward. Nicely. Oh.
Is it nice?
I don't think that was nice. Yeah, it was a nice idea. It was a cute play.
The thing is, Yellow Submarine can't venture to the other side of the map anymore, which is a big problem because they've been winning most of the five-man engagements, but if they can't get in a position to five-man, they're going to be forced to farm inside their base, Tiny outscales Yellow Submarine's heroes, as well as the Big Bad Roshan, which is going to be HellRaiser's big prize come a few minutes of pressure. So Yellow Submarines needs to pull something out of the hat right now to get like a pick on one or two and then sweep in a Rosh and then push out the lanes. Or they need to be able to kill the Tiny Wisp as they're pushing one of the lanes. But I don't know. Again, their like solo and duo skirmish potential is not that high.
It seems like Yellow Submarine are struggling a lot more than they were earlier on now. And Shadowfiend with the Invis Rune is just going to simply check out Rosh. But as we saw just then, it's very close to being up, just less than half a minute now at this point. Brash, he's questioning about going for a solo kill, but there is indeed a sentry here from the side of HellRaisers, and Gretz will be able to take down the Radiant one here, and I did not...
HellRaisers have a timeline right now. The Tiny and the Wisp are pushing the top lane, and it's an exposed Rax, so they have to defend it, and if they do defend it, HellRaisers just TPs and take the Rosh. So I'm very curious as to see what they're going to do in the next 30 seconds, because if they don't do something clever, Roshan's going to go the way of HellRaisers. BKB pops.
Interesting. Yeah. Actually, sorry, on the courier for HellRaisers, was that a point booster coming out for the IO? It is. So just a casual point booster to help the IO tank up?
What else can you build point booster into? Octarine? not the item. Scotty, I suppose. I mean, yeah, I guess HP.
Yeah, I guess. I mean, maybe they feel that they are going to end the game soon, and having a point booster for this next engagement could be all that the IO needs to have that extra little boost here. But I mean, yeah, the Tiny IO combo is looking incredibly scary. I mean, Tiny's had a fantastic game. 16 kills, 8 assists, and just 6 deaths at the moment, 32 minutes in. But Yellow Submarine, they have got the Wombo combo.
Oh.
Ooh.
This is a very dangerous place for Bane. Yes, Yellow Submarine wants to take control of this area so they can do Rosh, but HellRaisers doesn't really want to take a fight that they... may not win.
Straight in with the Fiend's grip onto Miposhka. There's going to be a Supernova as well. There'll be a Death Ward from the high ground. Very nice. Look at the damage he's doing here with the Aghanim Scepter. Suddenly, double kill. It might be a triple kill. No, Drip will be able to Icarus dive away. But incredibly nice Death Ward there from Fervian. And you can never underestimate the damage
what
that
happened
that
to
Aghanim's Death Ward
was Tiny. They relocated, but I don't think Tiny got latched there in that fight. I didn't see him at all.
I mean, off the back of this, I mean, this is a big enough window for Yellow Submarine to take Roshan.
That was a bad place for HellRaisers to go. I don't know why they ventured down the hill. All they needed to do was push with Tiny Whips until someone has the back, and then they just five-man Roshan. And then they fight a 5-on-4 with Phoenix Egg on the high ground. That's a pretty easy win for a fight. But at the end of the day, Yellow Submarine splitting their heroes very well. Mm-hmm. 4 heroes there. Darkseer was there to follow up if there were... again, I don't think that fight should have gone too badly for HellRaisers. I think 2 things happened. Firstly, trying to fight into the high ground. Oh, no.
Straight away onto Goddamn. Can they bring down the IO? Yes, they can. That's going to be a mega kill streak here for Miposhka. Pipes being popped by Yellow Submarine. They're looking for Dread as well. He's going to be able to Icarus dive himself away. But Yellow Submarine just scaring the side of HellRaisers away from the pit. And now, after defending that top lane, Fervi and Barash come in. And they know that there's no chance of any kind of ratting going on because the IO's dead. And this is going to be the perfect opportunity for Yellow Submarine to look to finish off Roshan.
Perfect. Exactly what they wanted. A good fight at Rosh, defend their Rax, kill a couple of heroes.
Very nice. Indeed, Aegis now on Barash. HellRaisers, they do have the BKB completed onto Tiny now. So, I don't know, if a fight kicks off, HellRaisers are going to... I feel like it's going to be hard for Yellow Submarine to take a straight 5-on-5 if HellRaisers get a good initiation.
Oh, it depends. I think mostly on the Witch Doctor ward.
Yes.
That thing just destroyed them last fight. They can't fight in a heavily obscured place like they just fought. Look at Yellow Submarine's wards. They have three Observer wards around the Roche, and HellRaisers made the folly of fighting there without the vision advantage. And they had no way to cancel the Witch Doctor ultimate.
Just going to see on the top lane, in fact, the side of Yellow Submarine, they're coming out, maybe seeing if they can find someone here. There's a Tiny and an Artes hiding in the sidelines. Tiny's going to jump straight in. There's going to be a vacuum coming out from Yellow Submarine, and now with the pipe, they're trying to fight back into this. Wall's being dropped. There's a BKB and a Stampede trying to get him out, but we've got PSM with a cheeky little toss back onto the Tiny. They're going to try and chase down Alpha Ninja. Where is your Io? Io at the moment, he is coming in here on the left. No, oh, there's going to be the Glimmer Cape indeed popped by him. He's actually relocated out here. Did he try and Tevrim relocate and it didn't work out, perhaps, because the Tiny's dead. Io's going to come back into this one, and I don't think there's anywhere for him to run. No, the Death Ward stays out. It's going to be a double kill for Miposhka. And I guess, again, did the Io try and relocate the Tiny out,
it
but the Tevrim
like
wasn't
it.
There?
He ran southeast, whereas Io was to the northwest. Does Rubick have any items? He just completely outplayed him there. Look at his items. He doesn't even have a Blink Dagger.
He's got it now, though.
He tossed away the BKB Tiny, and then they immediately surged him afterwards so he couldn't catch up. Like, usually with BKB Tiny, you're guaranteed a kill, but they Viper Strike him, immediately countered by a Stampede into the toss back from the Rubick. Man, they are making so many plays.
Oh, Goretz is going to be able to blink himself away here. Was going for a bit of a cheeky push. But indeed, now, as we're saying, Rubick spends his money. He's got a Blink Dagger. Talking about spending money, I believe Miposhka had a lot on the Viper just now. 3.8k gold. I guess deciding what the next best item is to go for. Submar1ne himself, he's got 3.3k as well with a bit booster. I guess he's going to look to finish off the heart at this point.
On Viper?
On the Centaur.
Oh, Centaur?
Yeah.
I suppose so. I'm curious as to what the Viper is going to go. I wonder if they're going to get like a Lotus Orb or something for the Fiend's Grip.
Oh, that would be fun.
Yeah. Does that work on Fiend's Grip? Probably.
I want to say yes. It's a single target. I guess, wouldn't it? I don't know. We'll find out sometime on another day. Artes, he's getting caught out here now. We'll be able to get the Stampede out. There's going to be a Viper Strike and a Cars coming out. Now with the Death Ward, you can't TP out of this, my son. Wall gets dropped as well. He will fall an Io. Oh, poor old goddamn. Is there any way? He's going to be able to try and tether up to the high ground here. But Dale, he's ready and waiting. He's brought Goretz in as well. Goddamn will fall. The cast bounces forward. And now PSM blinking towards the high ground. They'll get Goretz also. And I don't think the Bane's going to be too happy that the Eye dragged him back into that one.
Sick plays from Yellow Submarine. Yeah. They're pressuring them all around. And now, finally, they can actually push out their lanes without the threat of Tiny Wisp because of that blunder on the left side as well as the blunder at Roche. So I would say, again, they've presented HR with so many difficult decisions that they're bound to mess up at some point unless they play a perfect game. But they're making blunder after blunder, you know, a couple of failed relocates, not bringing Tiny, not being able to relocate someone out, even with the Aegis play on the bottom lane, relocating before his Aegis expired. And HellRaisers was kind of this Tiny Wisp is falling flat at this point. It's still Tiny Wisp, though. You always have a chance with Tiny Wisp.
Yeah, absolutely. There's always that kind of imminent threat of the combination. Shiva's Guard now finished, though, by Dale. And, I mean, at this point, do you feel that Yellow Submarine are at a, you know, are they strong enough to try and push the high ground off these tier 2s and go for the base, or are they still waiting for something?
If their lanes are pushed out, then yes, yeah. But if not, then they can't. I mean, and Tiny is just wreaking havoc on all their towers. We see Phoenix pushing in the mid lane. And they can try, but I think that HR will be more than happy to base race.
I was going
to
say, do HR back up for this one, or do they just try and go for the
HR,
aggressive?
I think they go for it. They don't have the Tiny, or they don't have the Wisp for this one, but I don't know. They're fighting to the Aegis. This is a very difficult play for them. Tiny, we can see, still on the bottom lane. Viper will TP back.
I've got the Viper Strike here, trying to scare away Alpha Ninja. And indeed, he's on his own. We'll have to pop the BKB and TP out. Now, top lane, Barash. He's on the high ground. He's been in fear, but there's going to be the TP coming in from Phoenix. And, let's see.
They want to take this fight. It's a 4v5. And they have the Aegis, but I don't know if that's going to be enough. We'll see.
Ooh, Fervian trying to position himself very nice. He does get the Death Ward out. There's going to be a Supernova here from the sidelines. It looks like it will be successful. Afanish getting bought low. There's going to be a BKB pop from Barash. And now with the wall drop, the Tiny Illusion comes out. Tiny's gone down. He does buyback straight away. Witch Doctor getting low. Fervian been taken out by the Sunray, but he's got the Voodoo Restoration keeping him alive. There's going to be a Nightmare onto BSM. Artes trying to get himself in close and personal with a Hoof Stomp. Goretz Glimmer Capes up props to the Enfeeble again onto Barash. And now, well, Afanish tosses forward. Goddamn, now with the Icarus Dive. Dread trying to catch out Yellow Submarine. Can HellRaisers find anything? Blinking forward here. They do find the Avalanche onto two. But Barash Ashe is still ready to fight here. Artes, he's going to miss his blink. Who's stomp? And Rob Rash simply TPs out. Dale here with the vacuum and looking for the cheeky plays. He's got a surge here in a second. Double Edge will come through. This Darkseer is fairly tanky. There'll be a toss forward. Can they bring down Dale? They will do indeed. Finally being able to bring down the Darkseer. But it takes HellRaisers a lot to do that and to stop Yellow Submarine. And Yellow Submarine, they do get the Shadow Fiend out and they don't lose the Viper or the Rubick.
That was still a full channeled Death Ward. I think they need... Is he close to BKB?
I think the Witch Doctor is, yeah.
Okay, yeah. Well, now he has BKB, I don't really know how they can counter it. I guess Fiend's Grip, but you don't really want to waste a Fiend's Grip. I think it's the right play, though.
I guess the one thing the Witch Doctor has got to be careful about is obviously dropping it down when there's a supernova. You know, obviously to worry about the stun at the end.
It still takes a long time.
It does, yeah.
He just channeled. He's like, I'm going to get supernova, but I'm going to kill the Tiny before I die.
And obviously, yeah, worth noting, of course, Alpha Ninja did indeed, as you're saying, buy back in that fight as well. And still, I don't know. It's 36-32 on the board at the moment, coming up to 40 minutes in. If we actually have a look at the net worth graph at the moment, there's up and down, up and down. HellRaisers, they did manage to get, well, not really a sizable lead. It was only 6K, which isn't a massive lead. So all in all, this entire game being fairly balanced between the sides. And now we're just seeing a definite kind of turn back towards the favor of Yellow Submarine. And well, there's a Scythe now picked up onto this Phoenix. And with BKBs running, I'd imagine a little low. How's the Shadow Fiend's BKB looking at the moment in terms of duration? Let's check it out. It is down to 6 seconds. So I don't know, Ben. What's your thoughts on the game at this point?
I think generally HellRaisers would be in a better position simply because they have Wiz Tiny. Yeah. And if you make one big mistake, you lose two sets of racks. But because Tiny doesn't have his buyback anymore and because they don't have a Roshan control at this point, then it's still very up in the air. Normally, I'd give HellRaisers a slight edge in this particular scenario, but there's nice movements all around, and the Witch Doctor is a little bit over-farmed at this point with BKB and ult.
That's pretty crazy.
I guess they can toss him as well.
I think, interesting, that Viper as well, with that recent influx of gold that he was on, he did decide to go for the AC himself, in fact, on the Viper to counteract the Tinies. And
That's a good item.
Oh, cheeky little blink. He's going to be fine. He's going to be okay. They're still smoked up, everyone bar the Shadow Fiend. Roshan, we don't quite know when it's up yet. We're still waiting for the timer to be revealed. Just under a minute. You know, some reason they're going to look towards the mid lane here. Maybe they can find somebody. Surge PSM forward. He's going to try and close the gap in and blinks forward. Oh, but the blink away just in time from Bane and Dread as well on the Phoenix. Will Icarus dive himself away from the jungle? So it looks like Yellow Submarine won't be able to catch anyone out here, but they're just going to form up in the mid lane and maybe look to try and push this one up to the high ground. And the question is, do they go for this? And well, it looks like they certainly are, but at the same time, again, Ben, the threat of the Tiny Eye means that, I mean, the fortification will come out from HellRaisers, but, I mean, the side of Yellow Submarine, they're losing their racks here. They do have the fortification. It will come out now for the side, and they have TP'd back. Nightmare is going to be dropped onto the Viper, but they lose half their racks here on the top lane, and, well, mid lane, the side of HellRaisers, they want to fight, going straight onto Brash. He's trying to turn this one around here with the BKB, and now with the Requiem of Souls coming out, hitting them all. He's being brought low. He's getting slapped down by Alpha Ninja, but now with the Viper Strike onto the Tiny. Oh, he still should have even tried to down his Garrets, but there's a Supernova coming out as well. Miposhka, he's in a lot of trouble. He's been left alone. He's trying to run around this one. PSM is there with a little bit of backup, but the Nightmare is trying to look to drop it here onto the Viper. Shiva's Guard comes out. PSM's in an awful lot of trouble as well as Artes finds the Hoostomp Double Edge onto the Rubick. Viper's incredibly tanky. It's a big job to bring him down, but they do finally do it. They take down the Rubick as well. And Yellow Submarine, they're getting ripped apart little by little here. They try to put on the pressure in the mid lane, but again, it's this Tiny IO. What do you do when you're playing against a Tiny IO at this stage of the game? How do you outpush them and outplay them?
You get gems so they don't have ward, so they can't split push, and then you try and gank them. And if you kill the Wisp, that's fine. And Tiny didn't have buyback, so he's of very high priority. And they should be coming up pretty soon, but now Roshan's going to respawn. And they can't give up Roshan, and they can't give up a Rax. Just because, you know, when it's one Rax to one Rax, I still say HR has an even bigger advantage just because you're that much closer to Mega Creeps. And Tiny just does it so much quicker than Yellow Submarine's lineup that you want to save as many racks and towers as possible. They also glyphed a little bit late. I think they could have glyphed with the range racks and made them think a little bit more. But they glyphed when the range rock was already down, and that's easy for HR to be like, okay, well, we're just going to peace out. And they saw two heroes TP as well. And no one hero is strong enough to take out those two. So when they TP two back, it's just an easy 3-on-5 situation, similar to on top where it was a 5-on-4 situation. So HellRaisers trying to spread Yellow Submarine thin, and Yellow Submarine, they have to push out lanes, they have to gank and kill these heroes that are the pusher threats.
Roshan is going to be up in less than a minute now. This is going to be the potential for the next big fight between these sides. Goretz is smoked up. And was just seeing if they could finally jump onto Yellow Submarine, keeping themselves here in their own Radiant jungle. And now with the boost of travel on the Shadow Fiend, he'll be able to help out a little bit more in terms of dealing with this split-pushing action from Tiny Iron. Might need to be careful here at the moment because we're seeing Barash. He's coming out that top lane. There's a Tiny Iron, and in fact, Radiant jungle nearly being able to catch out Goretz here. Goretz needs to be careful here. Dale's going to pop the Shiva's guard, but Goretz with the Glimmer Cape, he should be right for the time being. They've got the gem. Who's the gem on the side of Yellow Submarine at the moment? It's on the... No, it's just the gem on Goretz.
They really need a gem. They need to kill these wards ASAP because HR is just having free reign on their side of the map where they shouldn't be. They should always be in constant fear of getting cast into some combo or Rubick lifting someone into like a Requiem. And that fear is just not in HellRaisers right now. They're still pushing out very aggressively. Bane is on the opposite side of the map with a gem. And he's also able to plant some very deep wards so that they can control Roshan.
Oh, mid lane. We're going to see the side of Yellow Submarine trying, going on to Dread. He's got to dive in a second. And here we go. Up to the high ground. Cast will follow through, bringing him low here with the poison damage, but it's not quite enough. Dale's trying to get himself in. Oh, but he backs himself out. He doesn't want to commit. And Dread will be able to get himself only just out of that situation.
Ooh, the butterfly.
Okay.
It's really good for base racing.
Oh, goddamn. Okay, there's your answer. He's going for the Bloodstone here.
Cool. Haven't seen that before.
No. I mean, what was the stat there? The 12th IO of all time. Of all time. That's pretty impressive. That is if he gets there. He's still got a little bit of a way to go. But I guess we could see some clutch potential in the team fight, obviously with the Bloodstone Suicide. And big heals going out, of course, to the Tiny and the team.
So they're looking for a pickoff on top lane. They're trying to push it out, but they have wards in mid as well as bottom to see if anyone is pushing out the lanes. And if they're not there, they're most likely top, and or they're smoked, and then Tiny and Wisp can back off. So once they deward these wards with the Rubick gem, then they can go for a similar play.
Okay, Roshan is, of course, up now. The question is which side wants to start to look for it first. I mean, at this point, who's going to be looking to take Roshan? Who's going to feel more confident going straight to the pit? HR.
Because they have the ability to push out the lanes, whereas Yes can't really push out the lanes. They, because of, again, the like Blink Stomp or Glimmer Cape or Blink into a Fiend's Grip, they can't be out alone. And if they go as two, then that's even worse for Yellow Submarine going into a team fight. So they had to be very careful about how and when they show their heroes and how to push out these lanes. And you can see Viper's alone and he can't venture outside of his base.
Bottom lane here, we've got the Nightmare onto Barash. Now Goretz, he Glimmer Capes up, goes in with the Fiend's Grip. Now with the relocate from Alpha Ninja, goddamn, trying to go in, but the vacuum and the wall has been dropped. Barash, he's able to get off the Requiem. He's going to be able to live through this one with the BKB and the Pipe of Insight. They just turn their attention towards goddamn. He tries to head into the trees. Alpha Ninja's gone down here to the Death Ward. They've lost the IO as well, the head side of HellRaisers. And Goretz will be able to blink and TP himself out from the tree line. But very nice reaction from the side of Yellow Submarine there, bringing Tiny down for a good 100 seconds. He does have buyback, but that was not great for HellRaisers.
I don't know why HellRaisers made that play, because the Yellow Submarine just dewarded the mid ward as well as the bottom ward. And you know that one of the supports has a gem and is moving into that area. And then they only see one hero on a top lane. So all four heroes are probably on the bottom side of the map, or three heroes sitting behind the Shadow Fiend, and they just fell for that trap.
Oh, Goretz, he wants to go for these Glimmer Cape plays, but on the other side of Yellow Submarine, they're just going to find him. Can they bring down the Bane here? Looks like they can indeed.
Looks like they I don't know if they didn't realize that he had a gem, but the gem pickup was so incredibly crucial.
Absolutely. And off the back of that, Yellow Submarine, they're going to be able to get Roshan here. Aegis and Cheese. Aegis the way of Shadow Fiend. And Cheese goes to the Viper there. Oh, did they pop in the courier? Who's got the Cheese? It is indeed the Viper. So now with the Aegis and Cheese, I guess Yellow Submarine, they could look for a push and almost certainly try and force out the buybacks from HellRaisers here.
Yeah, it's looking really bad for the Tiny. Second buyback for him, and his net worth isn't going to be quite on top of the Shadow Fiend as he would like it to be.
Oh, here we go, Rubick tossing forward Barash here onto Artez. Artez will put the Stampede up with the Telekinesis holding back, and look at the damage being done here. There will be a defensive relocate out of the cask. Flying through, bonk, and the coconuts will indeed bounce. And well, this is going to give the side of Yellow Submarine space to get the tier 3. They might even be able to find the racks here as well. There's a fortification available for HellRaisers. Still 18 seconds before Tiny's back. They really want to try and save this buyback on Tiny. But on doing so, they might lose a full set of racks here on the bottom lane. We're going to see the melee racks fall here on the side of HellRaisers. They'll lose the range racks as well, almost certainly, as Dale goes in with the punches. And Yellow Submarine, they're looking to take a second set of racks here. They will have the Tiny back up and they will have the Bane up. Let's see what HellRaisers can do in an attempt to stop this. They haven't got the Stampede though. Viper Strike's going to be dropped down onto Centaur Warren. Summoner, whereas the Sun Yellow Submarine, they've still got Wall, they've still got the Death Ward as well, and that's going to be a second lane of Melee Rats going down in the mid lane. Dreadtron Icarus dive in, Pipe's being blocked. Now Afro Ninja going straight in here onto Fervian and PSM. There's the Fiend's Grip onto Fervian. Oh, there's the Rec Room of Souls, and now with the Wall drop from the Sun Yellow Submarine, they're trying to find him with this. Death Ward comes out. Look at it go! Everybody's dying. Garrett's trying to get out with the Grim Cape. It doesn't matter. They've got a gem. They'll take him down as well. Four heroes to fall on the side of HellRaisers. The mid racks will be cleaned up. There'll be buybacks coming out from the Centaur, the Bane, the Tiny, Yellow Submarine. They buy back on the PSM Ruby. They want to get him back in here as well for round two. Alpha Ninja standing on the sideline, trying to get into the fight. Artes blinks forward, finding Hoonstomp onto two. Dredd and Artes, they could be in trouble. Can they do anything here? No, Dredd's just going to melt. No, he just get off the Supernova. Now they're going to aim for the Sun. Alpha Ninja's with the toss there to hold back the side of Yellow Submarine. It doesn't matter. Dredd still goes down on the Phoenix. Vipe Drive dropped onto the Tiny. They're going to turn to look onto Artes as well. Artes will simply TP out. Alpha Ninja, the Glimmer Cape will not save you at this point. He's dead for 110 seconds. Cannot buy back into this fight. There will be a pause. GG, well played, is called by the side of HellRaisers. And what a match, Melini.
Was that a rage DC? What is going on there? HellRaisers definitely had this one in the bag.
Yeah.
I think if you could choose...
Look at that.
Yeah, if you could choose which side to be on at 40 minutes in the game, you would definitely choose HellRaisers. And they
missed... what went wrong at the end?
Well, the relocate without the Tiny.
Yeah.
And then they like went uphill on the Roche pit without vision, and then they got owned because of the Death Ward. Like, even the last fight, they Fiend's Gripped the Witch Doctor, and they still couldn't kill him. And then he just channeled Death Ward afterwards.
Yeah, he did indeed.
So
it was just, wow.
They weren't able to execute the split push properly. They got the split push down part, but the other three shouldn't be fighting. They only go in when they have vision and they know that they're going into engagement that they can win. Similar to the bottom fight, they relocate on Shadow Fiend. He BKBs. There's three teammates behind him, and they just lose everyone. So it was a couple of misplays from them, and that's the thing that really impresses me about Yellow Submarine. Yeah. They force you to make decisions constantly, and you have no time to think. You don't have time to evaluate, okay, what do we do right now? It's just like, okay, we have to react to what Yellow Submarine is doing. The decision making is just heavily impaired by what's going on around the map. I mean, for God's sake, there's like 60 kills on each side at the end of the game. Maybe not 60, it was like probably 50, but I mean, they are really impressive, probably by far the most impressive team from the open qualifiers of any of the regions.
Yeah, absolutely insane plays from Yellow Submarine at the moment. Obviously, the thing is, we were talking about in the draft, Yellow Submarine did get a lot of heroes that they're very comfortable in. If your HellRaisers in the next round, do you think you look to ban out any of these heroes we saw from Yellow Submarine in Game 1?
I mean, I would say the Darkseer and the Shadow Fiend both contributed equally, and they both had a lot. So if you had to pick in between one of those two, I don't really know, because both of those are really annoying. So is the Viper. I mean, the Viper, he was massive in the end, and I mean, they just work really well together as a unit.
Great.
And I'm not really I haven't seen enough of the team to know whether like Barash's Shadow Fiend is much better than like, let's say, a Storm Spirit or a different mid. So, you know, if HellRaisers did the research and find out what these guys play a lot. If they play with the same style, I definitely think they can play with the same style with interchangeable heroes. It's just a matter of which one is better suited for their individual skill.
Okay. Well, that was game one, ladies and gentlemen.
Nice.
And what a game it was. I mean, game two. Are you looking forward to it, Ben?
Yeah, that was great. That was a great game.
It was. There we go. Sorry. Thank you, production. But yeah, we'll be back with game two very shortly. Ben, it's been an absolute pleasure. I'm very much looking forward to doing game two, and hopefully you guys will be back as well for more action between Yellow Submarine and HellRaisers. We'll see you guys in a bit.